call this meeting, the Human Resources Committee, to order. It's Wednesday, January 18th. It's 6:40-ish, I guess. We're at the school administration building, and Mrs. O'Gara, are you going to call the roll?
I will, yes.
Thank you.
Mrs. Z?
Here.
Ms. Oden?
Here.
Dr. Murataki? Not here. Ms. Hohensie?
Here.
Dr. Brown?
Here.
Ms. O'Gara?
We have
a
quorum.
And Mr. Harrington.
Oh, we didn't have it until you called his name, did we? Gotta be careful about that. So, I need a motion. We're going to start by going into non-public. Can I get that motion from one of our committee members? Mrs. Oden?
Move to go on into non-public under RSA 91A32C. Matters which, if discussed in public, likely would affect adversely the reputation of any person other than a member of the Board of Ed, unless such person requests an open meeting.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Roll call.
Roll call.
Roll call.
Mrs. Z?
Yes.
Ms. Oden?
Yes.
Ms. Hohensie?
Yes.
And Mr. Harrington?
Nope, not
too. No, he doesn't count.
You're not on the committee.
No, you don't count, George.
Well put, Ms. O'Gara.
Okay.
Okay, we're in non-public now, right?
We are now in non-public, okay. And you may go again.
Off.
Thank
and
you so much.
I'll find you.
We'll be right back when you're done with your non-public.
Sorry.
Can you say that to the speed microphone? Could you tell the watching?
Yes, the meeting will continue after the non-public has concluded. Thank you.
Yours.
We are now out of non-public. Can I have a motion to seal the minutes? Mrs. Oden?
Motion to seal the minutes under RSA 91A3.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Mrs. Hohensie? And call the roll.
Mrs. Z?
Yes.
Ms. Oden?
Yes.
Ms. Hohensie?
Yes.
It's unanimous. And now, are we going to, shall we do the personnel first?
Yes. Move to...
Just a minute, please. Dr. Brown, you don't need to stay if you don't want to. I mean, if you'd like to. I know you've been here since 4 o'clock, so I'm wondering if you really need to stay here an extra
half hour. We'll see how it goes.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, then, can I get a motion for the personnel?
Move to adopt the personnel recommendations as revised on January 18th, 2017.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion, questions, comments? Mrs. Oden.
Do you think there might be some more? I know people have until
yes.
February 1st. Do
yes.
you think there might be some more?
Yes.
Okay.
They're bombarding HR with questions, so
okay.
I know there are more.
Okay, because it was a real low number at the, especially the retirement, so. Okay, thank you. And those would be brought up at the board meeting?
At the next
have
board
an
meeting.
HR meeting before to accept them? Okay.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Are there any further questions, comments, concerns? Seeing none, are we going to call a roll on this, or is this a...
Just all those in favor.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It's unanimous. So now we were going to go back to the unaffiliated handbook, and I would have to ask, since this is my first night as the new chair, I will have to ask for somebody to tell me where we are in the handbook, and I would like to thank Mrs. Oden for her outstanding work as the chair of this committee, and assure everybody that I didn't look to displace her, this was her request, not because she was a wonderful chair.
Could I please say, I think I am not running again, and I think it's good to have a smooth transition, and that's why I thought the chair should be somebody who is either going to run or who is going to remain on the board. So thank you.
Thank you. So, who has the page? What page are we on?
Do we have a
page 7. I do.
We do. I have one.
Page 7.
So who is keeping the... Mrs. O'Gara, are you doing that to make the corrections
mm-hmm.
when we finish?
Mm-hmm. And Mr. Hollowell was keeping them before, too. I think we were both keeping them. I know I have it.
So if there's anything tonight, you will correlate with Mr. Hollowell?
Absolutely.
So where on page 7 are we, Mr. Huffman?
I believe the last thing we did was hourly employees overtime and... compensation time, where that's where we resume. That's what I have here. We're resume right next to that paragraph.
Oh, so we want, so are there any suggested comments or changes to hourly employees, overtime, and compensation time?
Leave time. This is what I'm saying.
Oh, we're at leave time, okay. Mm-hmm. Having said that, is there any comments, questions, concerns there? Mrs. O'Gara, anything we need to be concerned about?
No. I had written a question when I was going over this. It says an employee is entitled to use accrued vacation leave, which is approved in advance by his or her supervisor. Is there any time limit on that? Do you have to like have 3 days or 7 days or no?
No.
You can ask for it one day and get started the next?
Yeah, everybody is usually professional and asks.
Okay. That was the only question I had. Thank you.
Any other questions?
I just want to point out this particular section. By the time we get to the end of this section, I just want to preface the discussion. Depending upon how long an employee's been here, they could have up to 50 days off a year. And you'll see how they add up. So I'm going to make a comment at the end, but I just wanted us to be aware that these days, they add up quickly. That's just basic.
Does that conflict with the sentence, employee may accumulate and carry over up to 40?
So you could reach 40, right, and then you're still accruing your vacation time. And whatever you, every year on June 30th, whatever you don't use over 40, you lose it. So it's always adjusted every year. And we can never, if somebody left during the year, I think we have a provision in here now that they still can only be paid out at 40.
Mrs. Oden?
Yeah, in that bottom paragraph, the last sentence says, however, the superintendent may approve an additional accrual of vacation days in instances where unusual district requirements reasonably prevent an employee from taking vacation time. I was going to ask, has this happened? And can you give me some example of what was unusual?
I don't think it's happened in a long time. I can't remember.
Everybody needs to speak up. I guess the microphones don't carry real well, so.
It would have gone straight to Mr. Conrad.
Okay. Thank you.
Mrs. Hohensee.
For the public's benefit, I mean, they're listening. These are unaffiliated, so like principals, and they have.
No, principals have a union.
They have a union. So
they're like me.
These are directors.
Okay. Directors, and we have coordinators in there, and the IT staff.
A couple
staff
of secretarial
are in
staff, too, right? Mm-hmm.
So these are in the classroom or in the school buildings. These are mostly.
Some of our positions are. So if there's an appendix, I think it's Appendix A, okay. And it lists, and the last time I gave. Did Tyler put it in here? I gave an updated list of all the positions. Mm-hmm.
Yep. So when they're taking vacation, is it mostly over the summer that they take the time off, or is it during the school year, or does that vary?
So only full year people have vacation times, and everybody tries to take it when they're not busy. So different departments are busy at different times. Okay. I'll give you, for example, for the HR department, we're very involved and very busy during the summertime. Because people are going and people are coming. So we're more likely to take time during the school year, which is actually not.
So they try not to be disruptive to whatever the district business is. That's good, thank you.
So I'm gonna go to the first one, was vacation. Are there any questions, comments on sick leave? We just did that, right? Or did we? Sick bank. Family Medical Leave Act. Mrs. Oden?
I did have a question. The last sentence says employees should notify their supervisor and contact human resources for the need to take leave and receive guidance. Is that all in writing? Is there a...
So the Family Medical Leave Act requires us to provide employees with their rights and their responsibilities when taking leave. Part of it is a notification procedure to us, and part of our process is to gain certification of verify the need to take leave is falling under FMLA, which is a serious health condition with continuing treatment, pretty much. So, yes.
But the guidance, is that written? Like,
we are required to provide guidance to the employee about the leave and how it works, what it protects. It protects their jobs, it protects their health benefits and other benefits while on leave. It also is called a protected leave in that you cannot count that time towards a attendance issue. Okay. So that's protected time.
But they receive a written sheet with all of that
so
on it.
So when somebody applies to take leave, we use the Department of Labor forms. We have to give them an eligibility notice that notifies them immediately if they're eligible for FMLA and documents the fact that they asked us for either leave for themselves or one of their family members. And there's also a service member part of FMLA. In addition to that, we give them the health certification form to fill out. And when the form comes back to us, we review the form, and if it's complete or incomplete, we have to give them another form that's called a designation notice, either where we have said everything is complete, we are designating your leave as FMLA, or you did not provide sufficient information for us to designate this, please get back to us.
Okay.
So there's a lot of forms.
Yeah, thank you.
Mr. Kaufman.
I'm sorry, Mrs. Zim. Just looking at this again, and every time I look at it, I get scared by it. Still on page 7, we're talking about vacation leave. We're less than 10 years. People accrue 15 days or 10 or more years. They accrue 20. And as Ms. O'Gara just explained, how they can carry over 40 vacation days. Now, if you think about the private sector, maybe they can carry 5 or 10 days over year to year. They have to use their days during the year. This is 40 days is a vacation to carry over is a huge expense that the district has to carry.
So it's very difficult, especially in the professional positions, to take vacation leave. I mean, I can tell you for myself, right? I don't, because I'm always busy working, and so job comes first. And I mean, there are times when we all family stuff, but sometimes it's very difficult to take that leave.
No, I understand that, and I'm just saying, but as board of directors of a business or $105 million, $138 million business, depending upon how you want to count it, 40 days is a huge amount to carry for. What are there, about 100 people in this pool?
So the 40 days is comparable to other school districts for what they offer, right. And the 40 days is for the administrators, for the management people. So the less than 10 years, 15 and 20 days, that's for the support staff, because we have two designations within this non-affiliated handbook, and they accumulate up to 20.
Right, so I have another question, just for my own edification and the people watching at home. When school is closed and the teachers, there's no classes, these folks still come to work. Is that true?
In the appendix A, you
where they may take vacation days.
In the appendix A, you will see that there are school year folks and fiscal year folks. Matter of fact, Mr. Hollowell asked me to put in the days worked that each of them have. So there was a revised appendix A that should have gone out, and it was in one of the previous meetings as well. And you can see going down the line whose school year, whose fiscal year,
right.
And how many days per year they work. You even have standard hours per week and what their classification is.
No, I just want to make that distinction because
School-year employees do not have vacation time because they have the whole summer and the school vacations during the year.
So these are non-union. So if, may I ask you what the process would be if you wanted to change something like that?
So the process that we're going through now is reviewing this to see if you wanted to make any changes. There is a process where the board invites non-affiliated members to come and mm-hmm. speak to them about changes that they would like to make or respond to the changes that you made.
So are you telling me that the process, and I'm not telling you I want to do this, I'm just asking you about the process, so please don't feel that I'm saying I would want to change this. But if you did, then it would be a motion from this board. And then it would go to the full board, the full board would accept or reject it, and from there, what is the process? That's what I'm asking
so
about.
So we're keeping track of all the revisions changes. So we'll draft up those changes. The whole thing will come back to the HR committee once we're done for another look over, and then you would move it forward to the full board, and then the full board would vote on it.
So,
you may want to wait until you have that meeting and have, I think you can decide upon the process that you want if you wanted to give a draft of it for everybody to look and gain everybody's comments.
So if Mr. Kaufman felt strongly enough to make a motion, he could make a motion at committee level. It would go to, there's still no process in the middle. They come after the review, the employees, after we've finished the review of this book, the employees will have a time when they are invited to come and present any concerns they have. Is that correct?
Yes. We haven't really gone through, so this book has only been around, I think, since 2011 was our first year that we established this book.
Okay.
And this is the first time that there has been a rigorous review of the handbook. So we're on new ground.
Mr. Farrington.
Just in reference to all of that, on page 14, it talks about the annual review of personnel policies, and it says not later than March 1st of each year, the superintendent shall recommend to the Board of Education any changes to these non-affiliated employee personnel policies and salary increases for non-affiliated employees not later than April 1st. Each Board of Education Human Resources Committee shall offer an opinion open forum. So that's, and then it goes not later than May 1st, the Human Resources Committee shall recommend to the Board of Education any changes to personnel policies. So the structure is there.
It's at the last paragraph. Mrs. Hohensee, I guess it's your turn.
Okay. I just wanted to say, I think Mr. Kaufman was trying to compare the district's approach versus a business approach. And I know for corporations, they look at carryovers, rollovers of vacation as a liability on the books. So they've shortened what you can roll over. And some companies are now saying they don't give any particular number of vacation days. You take what you need because they don't want the rollover. And I know that's, you know, only a limited amount. We're talking 15, 20 days. But what private businesses don't do at all is they do not give sick leave accumulating up to 165 or 140 days. How does this compare with some of the other unions? Have we compared this? Because I know the teachers' union has a maximum of 100 days.
That's for the severance benefit only. They also go to a max around 165.
Okay. So it is comparable in that sense. Mm-hmm. But this is something in private industry they just don't have at all. So this is quite...
They have better salaries in private industry. And they don't have so much on the benefit side. So there is kind of... So I'm trying to explain that there's kind of a balance.
Pros and cons.
Mr. Kaufman?
Can we get a costing of what our liabilities are for this group of employees?
I think Mr. Dunneman and the city do a costing every year. They're required, even all companies, even when I was in the private sector, we had to do a liability report on the sick time and the vacation time. So that report is done every year by the finance department in conjunction with the city.
So can we get the latest copy?
We can ask Mr. Donovan if you like.
I'd be curious to understand it in financial terms.
It is difficult. I'm sorry, Mrs. Oden.
I just want to remind people that we're in the budget season, so if it gets a little late, they have a lot of work to do with the budget. I know Mr. Donovan was here tonight trying to get things ready for the budget. So if it doesn't show up right away, we certainly understand why. And I think we should be careful as to asking for too many reports at this time, because I'm sure their plate is full, as ours will be after next Wednesday.
Well, I have to say, I agree with Mrs. Hohensee and Mr. Kaufman, but I also agree with Mrs. O'Gara. To be honest with you, with the issue we have now going on with our middle people, I don't want to stress that group any more than they're already stressed.
These aren't teachers.
These
are the administrators.
But
there's no union contract here. There's no step involved here. There aren't people.
But I ask myself, and you may be right, and maybe that's another thing we can study on another day when we have lots of people to do these reports. But if my thinking is that if indeed we're not giving step increases to teachers, then that probably means that we're not keeping. You'd have to check. So you have to go into each individual group and check as to where are they. Are we competitive or are we not competitive? And so if indeed we have not given them the raises that other districts are giving their administrators, then we would have a similar problem. And I guess it is a mistake to assume anything. You can only know when you know. And so, but I would not want to do anything without knowing it, because
That's why I asked the question.
Yes, it's a good question, but I think that Mrs. Oden's point is also a good point, that we are already...
No, if it's a yearly report, I asked for the latest one. I didn't ask for one that was up to date.
If that's the case, can you do that, Mrs. O'Gara? Go back
I
and get
will
the... See if it's already done. If it's not already done, then maybe we want to, I don't know, maybe we want to talk about it at our next meeting again. So we're on page 8. Is that the case, folks? So are we happy with no questions about the sick leave and the family medical leave, the sick bank? So we will go to page 9, if everybody's ready, which is holidays. And an open book.
So all the contracts usually have, a fair amount of holidays. So it's comparable.
You need to talk up. Everybody
does. The holidays in the non-affiliated book are comparable to others. So the secretaries have full year, and they have the same amount of holidays, I believe. And the principals that are full year. And the custodians.
You wonder.
And in the private sector, it's for a full year employee, it's typically this group of holidays as well.
Yes.
So,
Mr. Kaufman.
You just talked about comparative. You spoke to it a little bit, Ms. O'Gara. So when's the last time you did a comparative analysis of job title function across from our district compared to other similar type districts?
So all the HR directors for school districts in New Hampshire, we have a group and we do comparisons all the time. So we all provide data to each other on positions and salaries. And if you would like a comparison, it can be time consuming. Because everybody has to, you have to gather the information from everybody, and everybody's busy in all the school districts. But we do those all the time.
Okay, they don't produce a report once a year or something like that. It's
don't
just on
they,
demand.
And we're all in our own positions, and then we all get together as a group to share information.
Well,
to help each other.
Isn't it whoever does the, each group, you negotiate with each group individually. And so I think that each group, when they're talking about raises and stuff, they always say how competitive we are, at least everyone I've ever been on. So I think that's when it's addressed by the board to some extent. You know, for instance, when they're negotiating a salary increase for the non-affiliated employees of the district, somebody on that committee would say, or that team would say, how competitive are we, right?
No, the board usually decides on the raise amount for, and it's usually, the superintendent usually recommends an amount that everybody else gets, you know, based to meet the cap, and then the board
based
decides.
On the budget.
Right, there's no comparison that goes out for the non-affiliated raises. When you're in bargaining in the union groups, typically we ask for other contracts and take a look at their salary scales and see what's going on there. And other things that are in the contracts.
Sandra.
I still think that I think that when these races come up, it is not unusual for board members to say, are we competitive? It's almost a natural reaction that you ask those things. Mr. Kaufman.
Just for this class, mm-hmm. is it okay to say a class of people?
Category.
Thank you. There is no union, there is no formal negotiation session. I think what Ms. O'Gara was trying to say, or trying to say it another way maybe, is the board pretty much produces this and offers it, and then there's an open forum as per the document to discuss it, and I'm sure there can be changes that are made. But essentially, this is a management offered to the employees, I think, especially very generously with time off. And like I said, when you add all these days up for a 20-plus year person, there's 50 days off a year. And it's just a lot to me. But there is no negotiation. It's really management offering, here's the employment terms, and you either accept them or you don't.
I go back to George's point.
Cautious. Because if you are only one-sided, then the employees will form a union and you'll have another bargaining group that you will have to negotiate.
And that's what happened with the principals.
That's right. So I think there's a balance that you want to strike.
I'm just making a point, as I understand. And I appreciate, you know, the consequence of every action is going to have a consequence, right?
Some of these people have a group.
You need to speak up.
I don't want to.
You have to.
Well, my question was...
Can I use that?
My question for Mr. Sure. Zoden was, I seem to have a vague recollection that some of these people were in a different bargaining group 20-some years ago when we were on the board before.
I don't remember. Or my time.
Yeah.
I know the principals had a group and then they disbanded and...
I thought Dick Murphy, the computer, and some of those other people were in a different group.
So,
Dr. Brown's point, I think they have enough commonality in their whatever the PLRB criteria are.
Community of interest. There's a sufficient community of interest for some of these positions that if they approached another already organized group, they could probably get accepted.
And I have, going again, 1%. This year we pretty much had a 1%. If I look at that and I ask myself, did Amherst give their non-affiliated people 1% this year? Or did they give them 3%? Or did they give them 5%? And that's why I'm saying it is very important, because we don't make the state, but we have to compete minimally with our state, and to some extent we do compete with Massachusetts because we are the closest city to Mass. And so, as such, it's a vicious circle. We do not want to lose our good people. So that's why I say I believe that the question is always asked. In my time, I know I've asked it any number of times. How competitive are we? And again, going to this 1%, I do not think that Hollis or Windham or Londonderry even. We have some pretty high-end towns in New Hampshire, and those high-end towns, and do we want to be a training ground for the rest of the state?
Thank you. Do we have any back reports, so maybe now it's time to make a new report, but in terms of comparative to other districts, how competitive are we? Any recent report that you've had, so we could at least have a baseline of where we've been and where we're going?
That so you are, you're asking for a salary? So we have a lot of positions in our non-affiliated group, and a lot of those positions you will not find in other school districts. You might find a lot of them in Manchester, right, in a large school district, but all the smaller ones do not have the amount of positions that we have. If you want to do a salary comparison, I would say pick a couple of people, because there's not a lot of time around these days, not only with budget, but we're going into hiring season. We've got negotiations.
Our plate is full.
My so plate is full. So
there's no previous reports that you could just and they access.
Mrs. O'Gara, can I ask you?
For which position?
Manchester. Does Manchester have theirs online? For instance, could we go online and see what Manchester
nope.
No, they do not.
No.
Okay.
This is not a union, so the salaries are not
as public.
Right, they're not public.
Okay.
So, if you want to, usually analysis is done by specific positions. Nobody does an across the board analysis. They're at different times, and it may be like a superintendent search could be prompting it, or search for a principal, and somebody will go out and ask for, can you give us your principal salaries?
So we could ask a board member in Manchester to give us titles and salaries and do our own comparison, something like that, because it's taxpayer money, all of those titles and salaries are public knowledge. So if we have...
We could ask the HR director in Manchester to do that,
if
to
we
provide
had,
a list.
If they could give us a list, we could take our list, and the board members can make a comparison. That might be the simplest way that you wouldn't have to do a lot of work.
Mr. Farrington?
Well, I understand what everybody's trying to do here, but and I've tried to do it doing... principal negotiations, try to do comparison, and clerical negotiations, try to do comparison. And I think you're going to find a similar problem here. It's job descriptions are different, titles are different, mm-hmm. and you really have to look at what the, even if the title seems to be the same, you have to look and see what the district is expecting that individual to do, how many people they're supervising. There's so much that goes into each one of these things that it really becomes... There's no apples. Very seldom are you going to find an apples-to-apples comparison, based on my experience trying
and
to do
even
it.
And even, I mean, something as simple as a day's worked, right? There's different days worked for different positions as well. Mm-hmm. And different organizational structures, too.
I wish it wasn't so, because it would have been helpful for me and other things that I've worked on. But it just, my experience is that you just can't, because there's so many variables.
Okay, are we ready to move on? Thank you, everybody. So the holidays, personal days, bereavement days. So we will go to page 10. Jury duty. Military service leave. You ask yourself, do we have this? Do we see much of this kind of...
Not a lot.
Minimal, right?
Right.
I would think so, yeah. Extended leave. Any questions on those?
I didn't have any.
Page 11, where insurance benefits, health insurance, the Mr. Coffin?
Yeah, I just think it's worth, perhaps, I think, referring that these are city benefits, right?
The insurance is certainly city benefits, yes.
So we're tied to the plans that are provided by the city of Nashua?
Yeah, but it doesn't say that, does it? And just for clarification.
Across the board, all of the plans are provided by the city.
I know that, but if someone read this handbook, was new to the district, they wouldn't understand that necessarily. They know they get the benefits.
They would know during orientation, because we would present all the different plan documents to them and all their costs.
Okay.
Well, and they made a significant concession under Mayor Lozo, as I recall, on health insurance, right?
Across the board, Mayor Lozo unified, actually, most of the health insurance plans and the share, employer-employee share, was all standardized, pretty much.
So that one person wasn't getting a better plan than another person, that it was...
We have five different health plans to offer our employees. We have a point of service, two HMOs, one with Anthem, one with Harvard Pilgrim, and two high deductibles, and one of them comes with an HSA.
So that's insurance.
Are the contributions consistent with the union contributions?
The health insurance contributions are the same across the board.
And so then on page, again, as Mr. Coffin pointed out, these are all pretty much paid for by the city, and so most of the, I would assume that it would, as it was in the case of Mayor Lozo, it's pretty much up to the city to negotiate these because it's contiguous, it's continuity, all city employees under the same kind of plan, right?
The plans are provided by the city. The full-time employees have standardized employer-employee shares. The teachers have provisions for part-time proration, and this document has a prorated portion for part-timers as well.
And it has dental, vision, long-term, life insurance. I'm sure it's Mrs. Oden.
So you're saying the dental insurance and vision insurance for part-time is prorated?
No, health insurance.
Oh. Well, how about dental insurance if somebody's part-time? Is that prorated?
No.
No?
The dental insurance is paid by the district. And for administrative support positions, the district pays for the district's for the single plan coverage, and in management positions, no cost to the employee for a single two-person or family plans.
But I think she's asking about part-time employees. Do they get dental insurance?
There's no qualifying. Everybody in this group...
If they work, they're entitled.
Yes, okay. To dental insurance.
Okay.
How about vision insurance? Do they it says they get full, even if they're part-time?
Mm-hmm. That's, yes.
Do that's teachers been going, get that?
No, the teachers can buy into the vision insurance. By contrast, because I try to balance off these things, the teacher's dental plan that they have, the non-affiliate people, we have to pay extra to get that same plan. So there's gives and takes on both sides.
Not totally equitable. Or equal, I guess, is the word. Workers' compensation? Other benefits, New Hampshire retirement system, any questions? Of course, tuition reimbursement. Membership dues, mileage reimbursement.
So I have a question about the course reimbursement. There's a budget line item that we have, which is, what, $225,000 or something?
That's for the teachers. So that's the contract.
Right. So that's where I'm headed, is where in the budget do we have allocated money for course tuition reimbursement for non-affiliated.
You have to ask Mr. Donovan, but it should be in your budget documents with, Mr. Barrington can help with that.
We think there'd be multiple line items for the categories.
Yeah. Okay.
Membership dues?
I would like to see a grade of B or better rather than C.
Where are you?
The second paragraph of course tuition reimbursement.
Do we want a motion for that?
We haven't up to this point.
No, you're just going to change it?
We're going to.
The board is eventually going to have to.
We're going to put all these changes in that you're suggesting. We're going to have a red line copy. We're all going to come back and meet. Everybody's going to look it over, and then you guys are going to decide whether you want to move forward with it.
Yeah. I agree with that. Okay, membership dues.
So we are changing this grade?
I put a notation for it.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Membership dues?
That's a budget line item. That's not. It says contingent upon available funds.
Yeah.
It's more flexible the way it's written than any change, so it's.
So why don't we finish this page? It's now, almost 8:30.
That's pretty much the whole thing, except for the appendix.
I want to go ahead. You want to go ahead and turn the page and stop at the appendix?
Okay. More than one appendix.
Yeah.
We have appendix A for the position specifications, and we have appendix B for the longevity payment schedule, and appendix C is the sick bank rules.
Is that your hand, Mr. Kaufman? Yes.
Yeah, back to the mileage reimbursement.
Uh-huh.
Dane, I'm sure there must be some kind of a procedure that is used when people request reimbursement.
The business office procedure, Mr.
Kaufman? There is
and
one.
And then there's a mileage form, and then there's a rate that's set, comes over from the city, the IRS rate for reimbursement.
Because it doesn't, it says you can use it, your vehicle, but it doesn't say. It says, in other words, I was thinking something, reimbursement, this is language.
I think it changes, though, doesn't it? The amount changes?
Yes. Yeah, that's the IRS dollar. Yeah.
And so that's why they haven't put it in there, I think.
Well, I'm not saying that.
Okay.
I'm saying, when I first reviewed this, the reimbursement is contingent upon submitting a completed mileage reimbursement form signed by your immediate supervisor.
That's a business, it's part of the business office administration procedures.
So can we at least refer, can we make reference to that procedure here? Because I guess what I'm going to point them to the right place so they know how to do it.
Mm-hmm. So what are you putting?
I just wrote a note that we'll have to find the exact words, but that it needs to reference the business office procedure for applying for reimbursement.
Okay. And then state statutes and contracts? Anything on that?
Mm-hmm.
Annual review of personnel policies. Yeah, that's what we're doing now. That's the paragraph that Mr. Carrington referenced, right? So if there's no further, we will hold up on the last two pages to the two appendix, if you will, for the next meeting. Is there any further business to come before this? When's our next meeting? Do we have a next meeting set?
Does anybody have a calendar?
I have a calendar that was in the packet.
Yeah.
February, is it?
Budget. This is February 16th.
Yes.
February 16th, but no, that says February 15th, February 16th, yes, human resources, 6:30 to 8:30. Okay, is there any further business to come for this board, committee, I guess it's board? Seeing none,
you can always ask for a motion.
Do we have a motion?
Motion to adjourn.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye. 8:25.
Aye. The time is 8:25.